Welcome to our five-part series on glycolysis. In part one of the series, we will provide you with a historical overview of glycolysis and a brief introduction to the 10 enzymatic reactions in the pathway. Before we begin our journey into the glycolytic pathway, I just want to remind you about the concept of free energy within the reactions. For a reaction to be spontaneous, the change in free energy within the system must be negative. From the equation above, you can see that the change in free energy of a reaction is dependent on the reactants and the products, as well as the temperature within the system. Some reactions that occur within the metabolic pathways that we will investigate are not favored. Thus, it is necessary to drive the reaction to become spontaneous by either coupling the reaction with a spontaneous reaction that can generate enough free energy to drive the non-spontaneous reaction forward, or by using Le Chatelier's principle and remove the products from the enzyme's area as soon as they are made. This will help drive the reaction in a forward direction, as it will re-establish equilibrium. In this way, a small amount of product can be formed spontaneously. Continued removal of the product, or excess of reactant, will drive the reaction forward. This schematic shows the coupling of two reactions. The top reaction is non-spontaneous with a positive change of free energy of 21 kilojoules per mole. This reaction can be driven in the forward direction by coupling it with a strongly spontaneous reaction that releases 34 kilojoules per mole. The overall net reaction has a negative change in free energy and is spontaneous. We have spent a lot of time over the last week discussing the myriad of ways that our bodies use and need energy. The metabolic reactions of carbohydrates and other food molecules play an important role in generating this energy in the form of ATP. For carbohydrates, this begins with the metabolic process known as glycolysis, or the breakdown, lysis, of sugars, glyco. At the end of the 1910s, Otto Meyerhoff mapped some of these metabolic conversions by measuring heat trends and oxygen consumption in frog muscles. When the muscle is working, lactic acid is formed from carbohydrates, and Otto Meyerhoff showed that during recovery, this is followed partly by the burning of lactic acid and partly by reprocessing of lactic acid to carbohydrates. Concurrently, Archibald Hill was also outlining these processes in the muscles from frogs. In opposition to the prevailing view that mechanical movement and chemical processes were parallel sequences, Hill was able to show through measurements of heat generated by the mechanical processes that these were delayed in relation to the movements. The chemical sequence consists of a work phase, which is not dependent on oxygen supply, and a recovery phase when oxygen is required. Together, their work has opened the door to understanding aerobic and anaerobic metabolism, beginning with the process of glycolysis. They both shared the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in 1922 for their work in these processes. We will begin this section with an overview of the glycolytic pathway. The glycolytic pathway consists of 10 enzymatic steps that convert glucose to pyruvate. The conversion generates a small amount of energy. The pyruvate can then be converted to lactic acid or lactate in vertebrates or to ethanol in yeast in an anaerobic or oxygen-independent pathway. Or it can be fully oxidized to carbon dioxide in an aerobic or oxygen-requiring pathway that takes place within the mitochondria, shown in green. Aerobic oxidation yields about 18 times as much energy as the anaerobic pathways, causing them to be favored over anaerobic pathways. In fact, most animal tissues can only survive short anaerobic bursts that occur in isolation and don't involve the entire organism. The aerobic pathway is required to sustain life. Yeast also prefer to grow using the aerobic mitochondrial pathway. However, if oxygen is unavailable, yeast and other fungi can switch to the anaerobic growth and produce ethanol as a byproduct. The production of alcoholic beverages through this fermentation process is quite popular. A summary of the glycolytic pathway, metabolizing glucose to pyruvate, is shown on the left-hand side in blue. During aerobic metabolism, pyruvate would be converted to acetyl-CoA, where it would then enter into the Krebs cycle within the matrix of the mitochondria. Future lectures will focus on the reactions inside the mitochondria. Our focus for these lectures will be on the cytosolic reactions of the glycolytic pathway. This is a summary of the 10 metabolic reactions of the glycolytic pathway. The pathway can be broken down into two major sections: the energy-consuming reactions and the energy-generating reactions. People always say the old adage that it takes money to make money. The same can be thought about the glycolytic pathway. The first section requires an investment of energy in order to generate energy in the second half of the reaction pathway. Here is an overview of the first half of the glycolytic reactions. These are the energy-requiring steps. From our lectures on glycogen metabolism, you have already been introduced to three of the five enzymes utilized in this pathway: the hexokinase in step 1, the phosphoglucose isomerase in step 2, and the triose phosphate isomerase in step 5. Recall that the isomerase enzymes worked via an enediol intermediate, and that the phosphoglucose isomerase first bound to the ring-closed form of the sugar but mediated ring opening during the reaction mechanism. Both the hexokinase in step 1 and the phosphofructokinase in step 3 are important enzymes in the regulation of the glycolytic pathway and will be discussed in more detail. Step 1. The first step in glycolysis is catalyzed by hexokinase, an enzyme with broad specificity that catalyzes the phosphorylation of 6 carbon sugars. Hexokinase phosphorylates glucose using ATP as the source of the phosphate, producing glucose-6-phosphate, a more reactive form of glucose. This reaction prevents the phosphorylated glucose molecule from continuing to interact with the GLUT proteins, and it can no longer leave the cell because of the negatively charged phosphate will not allow it to cross the hydrophobic interior of the plasma membrane. Do note that both of these sugar forms, the free sugar and the phosphorylated version, are shifting back and forth between the ring-closed and the ring-open conformation. The enzymes involved in the reactions are specific for one form or the other. Step 2. In the second step of glycolysis, an isomerase converts glucose-6-phosphate into one of its isomers, fructose-6-phosphate. This isomer has a phosphate attached at the location of the 6th carbon of the ring. An isomerase is an enzyme that catalyzes the conversion of a molecule into one of its isomers. This change from phosphoglucose into phosphofructose allows the eventual split of the sugar into 2 3-carbon molecules. Step 3. The third step is the phosphorylation of the fructose-6-phosphate, catalyzed by the enzyme phosphofructokinase. A second ATP molecule donates a high-energy phosphate to fructose-6-phosphate, producing fructose-1,6-bisphosphate. In this pathway, phosphofructokinase is a rate-limiting enzyme. It is active when the concentration of ADP is high. It is less active when ADP levels are low and the concentration of ATP is high. Thus, if there is sufficient ATP in the system, the pathway slows down. This is a type of end-product inhibition, since ATP is the end product of glucose catabolism. Step 4. The newly added high-energy phosphates further destabilize fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. The fourth step in glycolysis employs an enzyme, aldolase, to cleave the fructose 1,6-bisphosphate into two 3-carbon isomers, dihydroxyacetone phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Step 5. In the fifth step, an isomerase transforms the dihydroxyacetone phosphate into its isomer, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Thus, the pathway will continue with two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. At this point in the pathway, there is an investment of energy from two ATP molecules in the breakdown of one glucose molecule. So far, glycolysis has cost the cell two ATP molecules and produced two small 3-carbon sugar molecules. Both of these molecules will proceed through the second half of the pathway, and sufficient energy will be extracted to pay back the two ATP molecules used as an initial investment and produce a profit for the cell of two additional ATP molecules and two even higher energy NADH molecules. Step 6. The sixth step in glycolysis oxidizes the sugar, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, extracting high-energy electrons, which are picked up by the electron carrier NAD, producing NADH. The sugar is phosphorylated by the addition of a second phosphate group, producing the 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Note that a second phosphate group does not require another ATP molecule. Here, again, is a potential limiting factor for the pathway. The continuation of the reaction depends upon the availability of the oxidized form of the NAD. Thus, NADH must be continuously oxidized back into NAD in order to keep this step going. If NAD is not available, the second half of glycolysis slows down or stops. If oxygen is available in the system, the NADH will be oxidized readily, though indirectly, and the high-energy electrons from the hydrogen released in this process will be used to produce ATP. In an environment without oxygen, an alternative pathway, fermentation, can provide the oxidation of NADH to NAD. Step 7. In the seventh step, catalyzed by phosphoglycerate kinase, an enzyme named for the reverse reaction, 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate donates a high-energy phosphate to ADP, forming one molecule of ATP. This is an example of substrate-level phosphorylation. A carbonyl group on the 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate is oxidized to a carboxyl group, and a 3-phosphoglycerate is formed. Step 8. In the eighth step, the remaining phosphate group in the 3-phosphoglycerate moves from the third carbon to the second carbon, producing 2-phosphoglycerate, an isomer of 3-phosphoglycerate. The enzyme catalyzing this step is a mutase, or isomerase. Step 9. Enolase catalyzes the ninth step. This enzyme causes 2-phosphoglycerate to lose water from its structure. This is a dehydration reaction, resulting in the formation of a double bond that increases the potential energy in the remaining phosphate bond and produces phosphoenolpyruvate, PEP. Step 10, the last step in glycolysis, is catalyzed by the enzyme pyruvate kinase. The enzyme in this case is named for the reverse reaction of pyruvate's conversion into PEP and results in the production of a second ATP molecule by substrate-level phosphorylation and the compound pyruvic acid, or its salt form, pyruvate. Many enzymes in enzymatic pathways are named for the reverse reactions. Since the enzyme can catalyze both the forward and the reverse reactions. These may have been described initially by reverse reactions that take place in vitro under non-physiological conditions. Overall, glycolysis begins with glucose and produces two pyruvate molecules, four new ATP molecules, and two molecules of NADH. Note, two ATP molecules are used in the first half of the pathway to prepare the six-carbon ring for cleavage. So the cell has a net gain of two ATP molecules and two NADH molecules for its use. If the cell cannot catabolize the pyruvate molecules further, it will harvest only two ATP molecules from one molecule of glucose. Mature mammalian red blood cells do not have mitochondria and thus are not capable of aerobic respiration. The process in which organisms convert energy in the presence of oxygen. Therefore, glycolysis is their sole source of ATP. If glycolysis is interrupted, these cells lose their ability to maintain their sodium-potassium pumps and will die. The last step in glycolysis will not occur if pyruvate kinase, the enzyme that catalyzes the formation of pyruvate, is not available in sufficient quantities. In this situation, the entire glycolysis pathway will proceed, but only two ATP molecules will be made in the second half. Thus, pyruvate kinase is a rate-limiting enzyme for glycolysis.